So I got some requests to do a shot-by-shot analysis of the first teaser trailer for Beauty and the Beast, because we were all so excited about it. And at first I was like, is there really enough here for a shot-by-shot analysis? And I gotta say, upon closer inspection, there is. Because sure enough, Disney continues with their formula for these live-action fairy tales, which has garnered them great success, and that is just going completely overboard. Not even, like, it's just overboard at first glance, but then when you, like, kind of, like, let it wash over you, like a tsunami of fantasy, you're just kind of like, yes, this is actually just enough. And I think to some degree, the other studios' insistence on holding back to try and be more sophisticated is actually what ends up making them not being able to hold a candle to Disney's live-action fairy tales. So we're gonna go through this. There's actually quite a bit to take away from the teaser trailer. And I think it might be the best yet. You know, when I talked about Cinderella, I had problems with Cinderella from a story perspective, but visually, I like to say they just barfed up fantasy all over that movie, right? Like, Kenneth Branagh was just like, bleh! And, you know, it's like, oh, I love it! You know, just like I said, a tsunami of fantasy. But while this has that, there seems to be also, like, some sophistication to it, which I think is taking it to the next level. So, very cool. Disney is not only continuing to use their trusty formula, but evolving it. All right, so let's get started. Now, we start off with the Disney logo redone with the Beast's castle. Well, actually, I feel this is more of a chateau, a very large chateau. I'm having trouble kind of like gauging the size of it. It doesn't look castle size to me, quite frankly. But we'll see. Maybe that front door is just like super big. But it just looks to me like a very big, grand house. But I love that Disney always plays with their logo. This is something new that they do. You know, they did it for the BFG. They put Big Ben in it. They did it with Maleficent. They created that castle, Sleeping Beauty's castle. And what's so nice about it is that it not only like sets the mood immediately. Into the Woods had a themed logo, but if you saw The Jungle Book, and most people did because it made almost $1 billion at this point, they are able to like go in to the castle, the logo, or come away from it. It's not so much an ad for Disney, well it is, but at the same time it's also the beginning of the movie, the beginning of the story. They've almost replaced, you know how they used to have the storybook open for a Walt Disney movie, and Jon Favreau, also speaking of The Jungle Book, did a nod to that at the end of his film, but this is almost like become the storybook that starts the movie, the fairy tale. So very well done. And I love these French gardens that they've put in the front here. That they move in the wind, the trees, the shaped trees, that's just absolutely stunning. And it just, again, it like I just said, it sets the mood. It's a moonlit night, there's a storm brewing, it's snowing beautifully and softly, and it just, it calls you in, like a great storybook illustration. So couldn't be a better start. I also really like the design of this castle with the swirls. I don't know what would be the point of that architecturally. I would think that would be very difficult to handle, but visually it's very cool. All right, so our tale begins. And there's the snow coming down, and we get a closer look at the house, and it's just spectacular. Now, there doesn't seem to be anyone at home except for this one room. I'm wondering where the West Wing is, by the way. I'm like, where's the West Wing? But it looks like the balcony might be a little cracked there, but it makes me feel like this is the famous balcony. Now, this is the balcony, I think from the ball, I don't think it's from the ballroom, I'm not sure. But of course, at the end of the Beauty and the Beast animated movie from Disney, they have that really, that moment where the beast, the spell is broken. Spoiler alert, sorry if you haven't seen Beauty and the Beast. But it happens on a balcony outside, and that looks like that might be our grand finale location. But it's really cool, like this snowy night with the moonlight coming down, and there's someone home. Oh, it's so good. Okay. That snow is 3D, baby. Now, this is, they have just the music starting to come in. This isn't when the music fully comes in. We're gonna get to the music. But this is a really interesting look at the ballroom. Let's go a little further here and get a better look at it. And you can see, as we look at these rooms, they age, right? Like time is passing because the beast has closed himself off and his house is falling into disrepair. So The piano, I think, is to some degree new. I guess Mrs. Potts is going to be sitting on there. It's got glitter on it, it looks like. Very Liberace. This whole ballroom, it's a big departure from the animated movie, which is just a bold move. But I like it. You know, it's the blues and the golds. There was no blue in the animated movie. Also, this does not look like the Be Our Guest restaurant in Disney World. So, you know, that's another reason you're like, why would you depart from what you've built in reality? But it has, of course, the classic doors where they're going to go out there and he's going to be like, you can go home, Belle. And everyone's like, why did you do that? I know, we all know the movie extremely well. I agree with many of you that I do not want this to be a live action shot-by-shot remake, because I've seen that movie, like, a lot. I would like to have a little bit more depth and sophistication to the story. And I think we're starting to get that, so that's good. I see evidence to that. So anyway, that's the doors that you go out. They go out into that scene. But they added a ton load of chandeliers, right? Like, a lot of chandeliers. And are those chandeliers alive? But anyway, they're down like that because chandeliers have to be lowered to be cleaned. So I guess they started to clean them when they, like, I don't know. Maybe they'll lower when they have, maybe if they're alive, they can go up and down while they're dancing. That could be kind of cool. But that's kind of what's going on here. They put balconies on the top too. And also there are no windows along the end. There's only the window there at the door. And it's usually a wall of windows in the animated movie and again in the Be Our Guest restaurant. So big changes, but it's really beautiful. And again, this doesn't look like the ballroom of a castle to me. It looks like the ballroom of a very large chateau. So I wonder if this still is a prince. If he is a prince, it's of a small country. This is supposed to be France, but I guess it's just he's a well-to-do family, so to speak. All right, they had a bunch of those back in the day. It's like the 1% of old France. So anyway, I think these designs, speaking of France, are very nice. They really play off, you know, it feels like France. You know, I think like you see like fleur-de-lis influences there, and then you can see the leaves gathering because apparently the characters that work there decided to, they don't want to do this anymore. Now, this is a great shot. You can see the webs being spun over time. Now, I love this. I stopped this here. First of all, when I saw that chandelier, I was like, Lumiere, is that you? It wasn't him. Or maybe he's just hiding because he's ashamed of his accent. Poor Ewan McGregor. We'll get to him in just a second. But what I love about this, oh, I just love it so much. I just be like, pick this up, this set up, and go put it in a place that I can visit. Like, talk about a set tour waiting to happen, right? We've got, you know, right now the Harry Potter one. I would really like to see this one take shape at a Disney theme park. Please make it one that I can travel to. But what I like about this as well, eat your heart out, Crimson Peak. What I like about this as well, sorry, I couldn't resist. But what I like about this as well is that it looks just like the hallway from the animated movie, right? Remember when the Beast is showing her to her room and he, you know, and Lumiere's like, say something to her and he looks back. I feel like that's this scene. I can just instantly recognize it. And it's just so beautiful and fantastic. And so the cobwebs spinning, so cool. Now, this is where the music comes in, and it's amazing. A lot of you commented on the music. The music is incredibly powerful, and it's almost just the music alone being shown with the live-action visuals is enough to just be like, to just get you your attention like 120%, 200%, is 1,000%. You're just like, what now? What's happening? This is amazing. And also, to the visuals, the credit of the visuals, as the music swells, and Alan Menken really outdid himself on this score. Howard Ashman, of course, as well. The last movie that Howard Ashman was very seriously involved in before his tragic death from AIDS. He worked a little bit on Aladdin, but this was his masterpiece. So you can see as the music swells, the candles melt. That is just one of the neatest things I ever saw. Like, wow. Now, I paused it here instead of let it go all the way through. It's just so amazing. And these are like waxless candles, apparently, because usually they'd be dripping everywhere and making it gross, but they make it okay. But I like that there is a desk back here, right? Is the Beast also a learned man? Maybe that's what will draw Belle and Beast together instead of just like, you know, there are kids watching, so, you know, we won't go there. But anyway, I think that, you know, the idea that maybe he's thrown himself into his studies is a really good idea. It's a very good choice. But I like that he doesn't just sit there, you know, trolling the castle all day. He's got stuff to do. He's maybe working on something. I don't know. But it's really neat. It's just really cool. So the music swells and the candles melt. Oh, so gorgeous. Now, this is important. Now, you can see there on the left, right there, you can see that the marble's cracking, which is very cool. But this is, and also you can see some things in the front as well here. More scrolls of paper, what looks like some kind of, like, you know, that device you see on everyone's desk in an old Victorian scientist movie, right? And like, you're like, I think it's a globe, but it's not a globe. I don't know what it is. But anyway, what's really important is that they've added parents to this picture. That is a very big change. And I'm curious to see why they've decided to do that and why they would have a beast who's so much younger. It's so pivotal that she sees a little bit of a glimpse when she starts to put the painting together, the portrait together, of what he might look like as a really hot guy, right? Like, that's like her starting to be like, maybe I shouldn't be so quick to dismiss him because there might be something, there might be a pony in here. You know, that's a famous political quote from Ronald Reagan, like, in all this bleep, there's a pony in here somewhere. So anyway, I think that's a really big change, and I'll be curious to see how the parents plan here. Disney's like, we need some parents to kill off. Please put them into the portrait. But anyway, you close in on this as a child, and then you have the famous slash. Although, again, slashing the face of a child, was he turned to a beast as a child? I'm not quite sure what to make of it. It's a big departure. All right. But good, we don't want this to be exactly the same. I'm open to departure. Now, this is the whole girl thing. Now, I like this because the door, all of a sudden, the whole fantasy seems a little bit more real. And I like that they show the locking mechanism for the door. That's, like, really awesome. That, like, really made a difference to me. I was like, wow, thanks for showing me how this door works. So that was really cool. And I like the tease. They're like, are we going to show you Belle? No, we're not. And then they did in just a moment. But then this is where Lumiere and Cogsworth have their first interaction. You know, we just hear their voices of like, is it a girl? Of course I think it's a girl. You know, it's that my French accent, my pseudo-French accent is better than Ewan McGregor's. And, you know, I know Jerry Orbach did like a real like mustache twirling Pepe Le Pew French accent. But, you know, it was very, very romantic and fantasy-esque. It worked really well. Everybody knew exactly what it was. Ewan McGregor's accent, he's been trying to warn people that it's not good. I think we had no idea. I think you couldn't warn people enough that this wasn't good. Because everything else is so good, it's really bizarre to see something come in and be so not good. You're just like, what the? How did, hooty wotty? One of you wrote, how did qual, on my live reaction in the comments, one of you wrote, how did quality control miss that? And that's like a genuine question. But I worry for Ewan McGregor because he's such a talented and also just kind individual and tries very hard to be professional. I would hate for him to be the laughingstock of this movie and the one thing that everyone's like, boy, I sure love Beauty and the Beast, until Ewan McGregor shows up on camera and he has the big number, be our guest. So let's hope he doesn't mess that up. So they have their little tete-a-tete. Now this is interesting, her going into the house. Now I'm wondering what's going on here because again, that can't be an architectural choice. They're like, one of the columns will look like it is crumbling. Like, why would you do that? Maybe I shouldn't be so hard on Ewan McGregor. All right, so anyway. But anyway, he should have a accent coach on set with him. But anyway, it looks like there's some kind of like stone vine that's twisted and cracked the columns. So I don't know if like the Beast's parents are like really like avant-garde art fans and they're like, yeah, we decided to do that with half the house. Or if maybe when the witch casts the spell, it kind of twists the house up a little bit too. I don't know. But you know, it also is the flower motif. Oh, you know, now that I think about it, the castle kind of is swirly like a flower. That's why you would do it. It swirls like a rose. And these are like the petals and vines and stems of a rose to some degree. Ah, very well done, production designer. That's spectacular. But anyway, it's a really neat house. It's very cool. And again, I'm like, I want to go here. Please take this set and make it somewhere that I can go. You know, when you saw Cinderella and they saw the castle and every establishing shot, you were like, CGI castle. Like, never for a second was I like, that exists. But this makes, I feel like this exists. I feel like this is a set and that I want to go there very badly. All right, I'll go in that house too. Move over, Belle. There's our rose, our enchanted rose. It's looking pretty good right now. It's not falling apart. It is blooming, though. Maybe it was like a little baby rosebud when he first got it since he was a kid. Now, I like this because I didn't notice this when I first watched, but when they start to, you know, rack focus to Belle, you can see the etching on the glass there of the dome that covers the rose. So that looks almost a little, maybe almost like it's either like plant life, you know, like supposed to be like flower stems, or it's like ice. So we don't know what the theme is, but Disney's going to sell a lot of replicas of that, I bet. All right, so coming in here, and now this is fascinating. Let's stop there. I had to stop because what is with this pinky ring? I have never seen a Disney princess wear jewelry much less a pinky ring. That is a very strong choice. Now, that'll either factor into the story somehow. Did Belle and Beast know each other as children? I'd have a little bit of a problem with that, quite frankly, but I'm open to seeing where it goes. I said I wanted them to play with it, so I have to let them play with it if they want to. But, you know, you don't have something so obvious like that if there's not a reason. Maybe it has something to do with her father. I don't know, but I'm telling you, that pinky ring is pivotal. Also, a pinky ring is like not something that like a demure young woman would wear. A pinky ring on a woman, especially at this time, is like someone who's pretty aggressive and pretty self-confident. I mean, I know her beautiful haunting hello is, you know, a little bit more fantasy-like and hesitant, but, you know, she is going into a scary, maybe abandoned house, and she is trespassing. But that choice, I think, really plays into Belle as an intellectual. And, you know, I guess that's the perfect word, as someone who is an intellectual, you know, who sits in salons and has ideas and reads books. You know, that is so it's just a fascinating choice. I can't wait to see what she's wearing. And then as we pull focus to her there, you know, you've got the Emma Watson trademark eyebrows. But what's also interesting here, you know, at first I thought she looked very young. You know, she looked very, very young. Someone who was still in school. And we're having a little bit of debate in that in the comments. Some of you are like, well, Belle was supposed to be 17 or something. And in these fairy tales, they're always 17. But as I noted in the comments myself in response to that, Disney animates their heroines as if they're in, like, late 20s. So, you know, but Hollywood's always been wonky with age, right? Hollywood's always all over the place, and they never, I think, depict age accurately. Through the whole gamut, you know, from like kids to like people, like adults to young lovers to even people who are supposed to be older. You know, it's always like they're just really misrepresentative of it. So I would hope that someday Hollywood would fix that. But that's not what we're discussing. But what I wanted to talk about here is that also she's surprisingly natural for a Disney princess, right? This is an extremely manicured movie. And everything is beautifully, you know, put in place. So you would think she would just be covered with foundation and powder, right? She would have like flawless skin. She would look like, as much of a fantasy as what of the rooms that she's entering. But she doesn't. She looks like a real person, even with like slight little character flaws, right, that just make her seem more real. And I think that also plays into the idea of Belle as an intellectual. And that's just maybe, that might be, I don't know if it's going to work or not, but if it does, it could really work like spectacularly well to have very real people inhabiting, you know, maybe not everyone, but just the idea that Belle is such a real individual, that that's what captures the Beast's attention, right? That she's not a fantasy, that she rings true. That could be just that could be spectacular. That could make this really work. So she's enchanted by this rose, and then they say, be our guest. Oh no, a petal! And then March 17th, 2017, buy your tickets now! Oh, it's spectacular. It's absolutely spectacular. So that's my thoughts on the teaser trailer. That's just the teaser trailer. Imagine how much more information we'll get when they start doing more of these. Look at that, like 20 minutes. That's a lot of information. I got so excited I messed up my mouse. Okay, but anyway, I look forward to continuing the conversation with you down below. Thanks for going over this with me in detail. And you can check out some other episodes right now.